Hello. So what I'll do today, I will tell you a little bit about my startup first, and then I'll tell you about the whole space of healthcare in startups, and I'll try to leave some time so you can ask questions. First, I have a question for you. How many of you know of or have friends and family who had cancer? Raise your hands. Can I get my slides up? Thank you. Next one? Okay. Ian, can you click on this? No, we have to go back. Okay. Okay, just, okay. So give us a second, but meanwhile, I can tell you that I did some research in Lithuania. I think Lithuania is number 28 out of top 50 countries in the world by number of cancer cases. So you're like way up there. United States is actually higher on the list, so we have more cancer cases in United States, but Lithuania is, again, 28 in the world, and it's one of the top countries that have higher rates of cancer. In U.S., every single day in the United States, over 4,000 people get diagnosed with cancer. Every single day. And in 2012, we had close to 2 million new cancer cases in the United States. You probably have seen all those papers about genes, BRCA1, BRCA2, and other stuff related to genes and cancer, but in reality, only a small percentage of people have inherited cancer, genetically related cancer cases. Most of the cancer cases are not genetic. And how do I know that? Because I was one of them. Earlier this year, I've been diagnosed with cancer. And this came out of blue, because I was always super healthy and exercised. I did everything right. I was eating, you know, healthy foods. And so it was shocking to me. And when they did all the genetic tests on me, they told me that my cancer was not genetic. So I was fortunate enough to be treated by top oncologist at Stanford, and I asked them this question. I said, okay, so why it's me? And there was no answer. The top oncologist, one of the well-known oncologists in the space, he told me, we don't have data, so we can't connect it to anything that was happening in your life that caused that mutation of the genes. So what people do when they get diagnosed with cancer and have this invasive surgery, well, I guess they start companies. So at least that's what I did. I start thinking about the whole space. And if you look at all the ecosystem of people involved in the whole cancer thing, so we have patients, and there are about 9 million patients, cancer patients in the United States. There is friends and family, caregivers, physicians, and researchers. So if you look at those numbers, we're looking at millions, millions, and millions of people. And all those people have data. And if you can imagine us being able to collect that data, analyze that data, and try to make sense of what is happening from socioeconomic, from environmental and other aspects, and try to see how those things, how chronic diseases can be prevented, such as cancer. So what we're doing is we're developing this platform, and it looks like any other social network like Twitter or Facebook, but there's few things that you can look at. So first of all, look at the left. You see those badges. So what we did with National Institute of Health and top scientists that do research in epidemiology of cancer, we developed a questionnaire. And that questionnaire will enable us to collect unique data that no one has today that directly relates to causation in epidemiology of cancer. And people, they will be answering those questions in gamification manner within the application, and they will be earning different badges. On the right, you can see the screen where patients can document the state of their mood, energy level, appetite, and activity level, as an example. And those screens have been changed since. But what we can do, we can determine certain abnormalities in behaviors of patients and notify physicians or friends and family and give some data to the patients before things go horribly wrong, because a lot of chronic disease or cancer patients specifically, they suffer from depression, for example. And it's very hard to figure that out. But looking at activity or even non-activity in comparison to what they have done in the past, what other patients like them, and how those people behave, we can determine and make certain alerts and other things that I think will be invaluable. And of course, we have a stream of activity. We can connect patients with patients like them, patients who like them and live close by. We can help them to connect with physicians and researchers in their field. Now, if you look at all that data we can collect about patients, the interactions within our tool, and combine that with data that we can get from other social networks, such as Facebook, discussion boards, and Twitter, and also open government data. And you can correlate all those massive data sets. So suddenly, you can find certain patterns and correlations that no one was able to see before. So we developed a certain algorithm that allows us to generate hypotheses based on data. So things that you don't know and you wouldn't know, but we can see certain spikes in abnormalities within data. And we're creating this data fire hose that can be used by anyone in the field, by pharma companies, agencies, government, everyone else, and researchers, of course, to help us to find all those reasonings that can that cause all kinds of chronic diseases, and cancer being one of them. Just to give you a few examples on power of the data. We did research just based on tweet interactions on Twitter. We were able to find severe interactions for certain new drugs that we have been developed by pharma companies. So pharma company has been notified about this interaction. Basically, there was a patch that has been developed for ADHD patients, and drug company didn't realize that that patch had severe side effect. So just looking at the social media data, just on interactions on Twitter, we were able to find that side effect. And drug company was able to pull that new medication out of the market, repackage, make changes to formulation, and put it back. On diabetes side, looking at social media and some government data and correlating that, we were able to find out that types of services have not, for diabetes, have not been aligned with cases of diabetes throughout the United States, which was very important for treatment and care of the patients. So this is in a nutshell, I mean, and we were lucky enough to get angel investors giving us money immediately, so we were able to get, you know, developers and everyone else to build the product. So this is what I kind of do with my company, and now I'll go into the second part and talk about the overall healthcare startup environment, and then I'll take your questions. We need to move to another deck. So we talk about the whole ecosystem for the cancer patients. Now, if you look at the healthcare, we need to add one more player to the ecosystem, which is hospitals. But basically, you still have patients, friends and family, caregivers, physicians, and researchers. So this is the ecosystem, and it's important for you to kind of understand it. If you're interested in starting a company in healthcare space, then you might need to understand who will be your users, who will be people who will be actually making purchasing decisions. Now, you have to also understand that healthcare spending in the United States, it's 20% of GDP, so it's huge. And there are a lot of improvements that can be done in any of those areas within the ecosystem. So if you look in the past, patients, as soon as they were getting sick, they wanted to find out why I got sick, what I can do, who I can ask for help, and how I can get treated. So in the past, it was us going to libraries, making phone calls, trying to meet with many physicians, and things have changed since. Now we have devices that measure our blood pressure and measure sugar levels and measure our activities. We look at the internet. So now the whole interaction, us with information, us as a patient, have been changed. So what I did, I kind of highlighted major groups of applications that have been built for the patients, right? So if you look at the different applications, there are food and diet applications, medical information applications, body checks, communities, health and fitness apps. So what you can say, okay, let's go. Let's build another app. Let's build one of the apps that will help people to connect with other people or to find physicians, to do some body checks. What I did next, I said, okay, let me look at the Apple Store and see how many of applications have been built in some of the key areas, right? So the numbers are huge. So there are over 400 applications on diet. On medical apps within that category, there are over 2,000 applications. In over 2,000 applications, fitness apps. So before you go and start building another app in this space, I think you need to kind of go and do research and understand that there are just way too many apps right now in the App Store. And before you go and build yet another one, you need to understand there is a competition. A, B, how you will be able to recruit people to use your app. And then I look at the gadgets, all kinds of devices. There are lots of them. So if you start looking at, you know, making another measurement device, you also have to do your homework. Because there are too many devices. In general, I think I was mentoring a startup in this space. It's very, very difficult to get funding for yet another device in this space. So if you look at the physicians, those are main categories where they need help with. So assistance in diagnosis, remote monitoring, reminders, alerts, references, and productivity. Those are main areas where physicians are looking at application developers to help them out. The good thing is that in 2013, we had over 90 digital health companies funded, and each of them raised over $2 million. So there are quite a bit of investments is going on in digital health space. Here's the largest five deals of 2013, and you can see the sizes of those investments. As you can see, HealthTap that helps patients to find physicians and get information about their diseases got $24 million. And you can read about the other ones. So investments are happening in this space. Now, what I did, I decided to pull top areas where most of the investments happened in 2013. So you can see in the remote monitoring space, there were 12 deals, value of $102 million. The reason you need to understand this is basically that indicates the areas where you potentially want to focus when you're building your app. There were 8 deals in hospital system space, also at $80 million. Analytics and big data space, quite big, and I think that will be that will probably attract more investments because there's too many areas where big data can help in healthcare, from genetics to what we're doing and some other stuff. Electronic health records, big space, as you know. And of course, wellness apps. So this basically indicates the areas where investors putting their money in those spaces. It doesn't mean that there is no competition, but at least this is the spaces that are right now getting some money. Now, how you can get some money for your early stage startup? We talked yesterday about accelerators. So what I did, I pulled top 10 accelerators, and this is based on Forbes analysis of accelerators in the United States, and I think they looked at number of factors, how they determined top 10. And the good thing is that you can write down those names and look at the applications. Most of those accelerators, they give you some money. Some of them give you space, some don't. They take some equity, but they help you a lot. And those are top 10 by ROI, so by companies who have been successful after they graduated from accelerators. And you can see the 500 startups and Y Combinator, of course, and some other ones. They're based in different places. Some of them based in California. There are some in Chicago and I think in other areas as well. Now, there is a whole bunch of accelerators that specifically focused on healthcare. And I think if you are thinking about company in healthcare space, you really want to go and look at portfolio of startups who went through those accelerators. The nice thing about those specialized accelerators, they have all those key players within the healthcare ecosystems participating. So they have people from major hospitals and healthcare organizations and other places. So that gives you immediate access to some potential users or companies who can pay for their apps. So I think I really suggest you're looking at those healthcare specific accelerators. They're based again in different locations. So, and see if you can apply, but at least see what type of companies they accept and definitely apply. And to conclude, I want to say that healthcare startups can save lives and also can make money. So if you have any questions, please, I'll answer those questions now. Thank you.